The death penalty exists in 33 states of the United States of America. However, in recent years, a much smaller number has actually performed them. Executions are carried out by lethal injection. In certain cases, execution by firing squad is still permitted in Utah and Oklahoma. As a German, coming from a different historical background, and being a guest in the United States, I respectfully disagree with the practice of capital punishment. The execution chamber itself is located in Huntsville, Texas. Death row inmates are held here, some 40 miles away at Polunsky Unit, near Livingston. Here, we were allowed to meet Robert Frattar, who was sentenced to death for conspiring and instigating the murder of his wife Farah. In fact, his conviction was summarily overturned some 11 years after he was sentenced to death. In a second trial, with key confessions of co-defendants ruled inadmissible, he was still found guilty and sentenced to death again.
Robert Frattar, thank you very much for meeting us.
Thank you.
Can you describe your wife Farah in the best moments you had?
Sure. In the beginning, what was funny was I wasn't very attracted to her physically, but she was just, she treated me wonderfully. And she was already engaged to somebody from England, and yet she still kept pursuing me knowing I was dating other women. And I felt that as she was coming over to my apartment and as she'd want to cook for me, clean for me, do my clothes for me, I'm like, this woman's wonderful. So I kept praying to God, saying, is this the woman that you want me to marry? Because I grew to love her and fall in love with her for the personality that she was, and based on the way she was treating me. So yeah.
She was beautiful.
Here again, I thought she was attractive, but she wasn't she was only like 5'4" and about 116 pounds when we met. Well, I always liked bigger women then, because I was always on the small side, and so I wanted to marry a woman who was large so my children wouldn't grow up like me being small and picked on. So no, she didn't meet the physical attributes of what I was looking for in a wife, but I felt like, hey, this must be the woman that God wanted me to marry. So.
And you were very much into your out in your appearance. You wanted to look beautiful, and I've seen photos of you from the 1990s. You look very handsome.
Oh, well, thanks. But I guess it was more insecurity. It was because I was always short and skinny. I worked out and took karate just to get bigger so people wouldn't pick on me so much. That's how it started. I got out of the bodybuilding competing very quickly because it was just I got to the point where competing was too much hard work, and I didn't enjoy that. I enjoyed just the socializing, working out aspect of things.
But you were always very well groomed.
Yeah, well, people
took care of yourself.
I cut my own hair. I've been cutting my own hair since the 80s. I'm not one like spends $400 on haircuts. So, you know, people would always look at me and think that I was so into the beauty aspects. And no, my hair, I kept short, so it just combs into place. It, you know, bodybuilding, I worked out.
Tanning studio?
Yeah, the tanning studio to get a tan, yeah.
This video was shot shortly before Farah Frattar's murder. This is Humble, Texas, a suburb of Houston. Everything looks secure, serene. Farah's three children and neighborhood kids enjoy playing in the autumn leaves. And here, with a baseball bat, Farah. In an earlier video, shot during the summer, children around a playhouse in the garden. This is where the murderer would lay in wait. And here, her daughter Amber, the youngest child. She enters the garage. Where she steps right now, her mother would be gunned down and die. The trigger man would enter through the door in the background.
And this is actually the murder scene here, where the murder occurred. From what we witnesses told us, and then what happened was Farrah came home, and she pulled her car right this straight ahead here, and then backed it into the garage on this side. The neighbors across the street saw that, and they were used to her coming in like that. And she got it, the garage doors open, and when Farrah got out of the car, a man came through the side garage door there and shot her one time. And they heard the shot, saw her go down, and then he stepped out and he stepped back and shot her one more time while she was laying on the pavement. Then he exited. They didn't see him again. In a short period of time, a car pulled up right up here on the street. And there was, at that time, there was a bush at the end of this garage. And the man, they saw the man run in from behind the bush and get in the car. Bob Ferrato became a target relatively quick in the investigation. The problem was he was alibied. He was actually at a Catholic church in Humble with his two boys and at the time this happened.
This was filmed in the same church years before during the baptism of one of the Frata children.
It is to just such as these that the kingdom of God belongs.
We interviewed him for a lengthy period of time during the night. He also got a consent to search his car, found, I think, $1,050 in his car plus a handgun. And anyway, he was released the next morning.
A local news station filmed him on that very morning. He seemed to be concerned about his looks.
And I hope they find the guy. Soon.
Basically, what Frata did is he and his wife were involved in a divorce. He didn't want to pay child support. He didn't want custody of his children, but he filed for custody simply because it was a way of winning for him. As the divorce proceedings went along, he became more angry and very bitter and began to approach people saying, "Would you kill my wife for me? Do you know anyone who would kill my wife for me?" He eventually found someone who was willing to do that.
He approached quite a few.
He approached at least 7 people that we know about. It could have been more, actually. He found someone who said, "I will participate." This person found the shooter, and so we ended up having 3 people involved: Frata, who hired someone to kill his wife, Prystash, who was the middleman, and Guidry, who was the shooter. And they waited until she was coming home one evening. Frata had his children with him, so he would have an alibi. And while he was out with his children, he knew that this was occurring. Guidry shot his
wife.
He was at church. He was visible. One thing he didn't count on, though, is that there were phone records that showed that there were phone calls made all night long between his pager, between a pager that was leased by Prystash's girlfriend at the church. And so they were communicating with each other all night while this offense was occurring.
End result is that 3 men are on death row.
Yes.
Robert Frata.
Howard Paul Guidry, the shooter. Joseph Andrew Prystash, the middleman. And Robert Frata, who started all of it. Actually, the way the case really began to unravel, because obviously the police suspected Frata from the beginning, and they found an address book in Frata's car which had Mary Gipp's phone number. Mary Gipp was Prystash's girlfriend. And Guidry robbed a bank here in Houston.
Guidry was a neighbor.
He was a neighbor of Prystash's girlfriend, yes. And he robbed a local bank, and as he literally was fleeing on foot with packets of the money falling out of his back sack, he was arrested, and in his back sack was the murder weapon that was used to kill Farrah Frata. The murder weapon, federal records show, had been purchased by Robert Frata.
Guidry actually was the shooter.
He was actually the shooter. He was actually the shooter.
And he confessed in detail.
He confessed in detail, in writing, on a witness, not a witness statement, but a defendant statement form that had all of his rights outlined on top of each one he initialed every right. Before he signed the statement, he initialed all the paragraphs of the statement, and then he signed the statement.
Yeah, his Miranda rights.
Yes, sir, his Miranda rights. After this was over, I asked him that night, by this time it's after midnight, I asked Howard if he would go with us to the scene that night and do a walkthrough at the scene. He agreed to do it.
Whenever I was finished.
When you were finished, what are you referring to when you finish?
Whenever I killed the girl, Colin, and he'll be waiting by this phone. And that's basically it for here. But he called Bob, and Bob was at church with his children.
Where'd you get the pistol from?
From Howard. Joe. I got the pistol from Joe. Maybe 30 minutes before we got here, back at the apartments, Joe gave me the gun.
Okay, Howard, just like before, I'd like to read this to you and tell me that you understand everything. You have the right to remain silent and not make any statement at all, that any statement you make may be used against you and probably will be used against you at your trial. Do you understand that?
Yes, sir.
Any statement you make may be used as evidence against you in court. Do you understand that?
Yes, sir.
You have the right to have a lawyer present to advise you prior to and during any questioning. Do you understand that?
Yes, sir.
The fact that there was no lawyer present later led to allegations of coercion. This resulted in Guidry's murder conviction being overturned.
Yes, sir. Okay. Do you wish to talk to us?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
Yes, sir.
Why don't you, in your own words, Howard, why don't you tell us what happened here?
I was dropped here about between 5:30, 6, sometimes between there. And from here, I went across.
Right, I'll walk. Sure, let's walk. Okay. We're entering the rear yard of the Fratto residence. Okay. Howard, if you would look at the camera and tell us what's back here.
Back here? What did I do back here?
Yeah, please tell everybody what happened back here. What you did when you jumped over the fence.
I came over the fence. And I ran to the house that Joe had told me about. I had never seen it before. But he had told me about it. So I ran into the house. And I sat out for approximately maybe 20 minutes. And I gave him a call from the cellular phone to the pay phone. And I told him that she hadn't made it back yet. And then I hung up the phone with him. He told him just to wait it out, and I hung up the phone with him. And maybe 10 minutes after that, a car pulled in to the garage. So when the car pulled in, I came out of the little house and I walked up to right here. And I stood right here with 38 in my hand. And I waited for somebody to come to the door, but nobody came, but I heard noises. So I creeped around like this and I checked the door, but it was locked from the outside. So I just waited. And then when the door finally opened, I walked in, I faced the woman. We was face to face, and I turned to the side like this, and we was face to face like this, and I had the gun in my hand. And when she did like this, I pulled the gun up and I shot her once in the head, and she like fell to the side, or slumped to the side. And I started to run out, and as I started to run out, she wasn't really dead, so I turned around and I closed my eyes and I shot her one more time in the head. And then I exited this door right here, and I turned and looked once to see if anybody was looking, and nobody was looking. So I came and I ran.
All right, if you would turn and look, face the camera.
I made the phone call to Joe to let him know that I was ready to go, and it was over. And he came within 30 seconds to maybe 30 seconds, 45 seconds at the most.
Guidry was already under arrest for the bank robbery, but now the dominoes came down. Price Dash was arrested and confessed. And then Frotta was taken into custody.
His handcuffs were awfully tight, and I didn't do it.
You look like in good shape to me.
Looks can be deceiving, but yes.
Yeah. And you have been incarcerated now for?
Since 1995.
Since 1995, yes. So 17 years.
Yeah.
How do you keep in shape?
Actually, I don't know that I am very much in shape, but I do maintain some exercising. I used to work out beforehand out in the world, so it's more just a matter of I do a little maintenance, but not a whole lot. There's no weights here or anything. So we just have to do push-ups and pull-ups, things like that.
You're not allowed any weights?
No.
In the yard?
No, there are none.
The plot of the crime can be traced back to this gym, formerly known as the President and First Lady Club. Mike Eden still works out here. He was one of several muscle men solicited by Frotta, but declined.
You could have been on death row as well.
Right.
If you didn't have a clear structure of values.
True, true. I mean, I went through my divorce, and it wasn't easy. But I don't think I would ever do that, because I actually went through a situation with my ex-wife then, and I was, when she was in an accident, I was there by her side, and that's the mother of my children.
Yes.
So I don't think that I would do that.
But you could have gotten $1,000 and
didn't want that. I wasn't interested in that.
Possession of a car as well.
I wasn't interested in that. I just wanted this guy off my back to get away from me because what he had questioned you to begin with, and not knowing he had solicited other people.
And you're not easily scared?
No.
You are strong?
I'm strong.
Confident?
Yes.
Principled?
Yes.
That saved you?
Yeah.
That made the difference?
True.
Something disquieting for me, and that's a subculture of gyms, pumping iron, sculpting your body beautifully, going to the tanning studio, having the perfect ready smile with the perfect teeth. Could it be that two specimens of almost perfection meet, marry, have children, and what remains is murder?
I know what you're saying about that culture, that subculture. As a person that has worked out most of my life, mostly because of the type of work I did and tried to stay in shape, well, I don't want to really talk too critical, but I know the kind of people you're talking about, and I know the kind of people who are, I guess basically say they're in love with their own body.
Most of the people involved in this, except Guidry was really not part of the gym culture. Frotta was, Price Dash was. This is how Frotta met Price Dash. Farrah Frotta went to the gym frequently. It was very important for Robert Frotta for his wife to look a certain way. He paid for breast implants. He wanted her to always look exactly the way she should, because to Frotta, Farrah Frotta was a possession. He owned her, and this is the way he treated her. So everyone knew each other, or they knew each other by sight.
Upon us leaving the gym, we were headed back to my apartment. He said, "You want to go by the house?" And I said, "By the house?" And he goes, "Yeah, by the house where the scene was at." And I went, "No." Because I knew what was on the house. On the garage door, somebody actually came across with some paint and painted "murderer" on the garage door. And I didn't need to be in that. I didn't need to be in that area of that. And then we proceeded to go back to my apartment.
So there was something eerie, something spooky about it.
Yes. He gave me a ride back to my apartment. And when he came into my apartment, he said, "You mind if I walk around and check your apartment?" I said, that's okay with me. Well, upon doing that, he goes into the back bedroom where I sleep, and my bed is against the window there, no headboard. And he asked me, he goes, "You always sleep with your head against the window?" I said, "Yeah, it's November. They keep the windows open and the breeze comes in. Comfortable for me. And that's a good place for somebody to shoot you in the head. Just walk by and shoot you in the head." And I went, "That ain't gonna happen here." You know, I said, "You know, what kind of crazy line is that, you know?" So he comes into the kitchen, and he sees a card on my refrigerator, and my brother was doing prison time himself. And he said, "What is that there?" I said, "It's a card my brother made in prison." That's what they do in prison. They make birthday cards and license plates. Try to get his attention and see how he would respond to that. And he goes, "Oh, okay." So then he gets ready to leave. He goes, "I guess I'll go now." And he gets ready to walk out the door, and he goes, "I guess I'll go." And I said, "Okay." I said, "Hey, Bob, stay out of trouble." And he turned around, looked at me, and he goes, "What could be worse than capital murder?" Meaning, probably, my opinion, that they've already accused me of capital murder, so what could be worse? What more trouble could I get into?
It was almost like a confession.
True, yes.
Could it be that there was something in this cult of bodybuilding, of tanning, of male and female enhancements, that there's a dark side to it?
There definitely was a dark side to it where Frada was concerned. Frada was diagnosed as narcissistic and also having an antisocial personality disorder. And people who are narcissistic and who are antisocial, it's not that they don't know right from wrong, but they don't care. And they feel like that whatever they want to do is justified. And Frada, he exhibited this through the body, the work that he did on his body. Even by his second trial, Frada was still pumped up.
That's it for now. This is, again, August 31st. Hi, Bradley. Oh, Bradley? Well, we've got him here. Go down there, Bradley. Do push-ups.
Do push-ups.
Go ahead. Do push-ups. Good boy. Push-ups. Good boy, Bradley. Good boy. Okay, Bradley, that's good. Good boy.
Ironically, the men he approached at the gym and who he asked if they would kill Farrah Frada for him or if they would find someone to kill Farrah Frada, when they testified at trial, a couple of them were, it was very obvious that they still admired Frada. They admired him for his bodybuilding. They admired him for his dedication to his body. And even though that they knew that he had arranged to have his wife killed, they admired him.
How methodical a bodybuilder was he?
He was extremely methodical. He, in fact, some of his gym friends commented on this, that he was so dedicated in his workouts. He would come and one day he would work one area of his body. The next day he would work the other area. He would work 1 and 2 hours at a time. He did this daily. It was a ritual to him. I think that with his narcissistic tendencies, it was an affirmation for him him to stand in front of the mirrors at the gym and to see that he had sculpted and created what he considered the ideal person.
And all this was combined with some bizarre sexual behavior?
Yes, he practiced corpophilia. And not only did he practice it, he even admitted it to the psychologist who interviewed him during the custody proceedings. Corpophilia meant that one of the things that he liked to do during sex, he would like women to use the bathroom basically on him so he could eat the feces. He would have women urinate on him. Even though he wanted Farrah Fraudah to be perfect in the way she looked, he also had affairs with women who were obese. And he had very, very odd sexual practices.
But it sounds like a contradiction that an obese woman who is not the perfectly mm-hmm. shaped, sculpted, and tanned woman would be his preference.
It is a contradiction, and I'm not a psychologist, so I can't really answer it. I would think, though, just as a lay person, it would almost be that would be someone he could achieve great supremacy over. He would be the perfect specimen and this woman would not. But as far as someone that he called his wife and that he exhibited publicly, she had to be perfect.
Oh, without a doubt. There was unusual sex. I mean, we knew some of the problem between them was the things he had asked her to do sexually that she would not perform. And then, of course, we found witnesses that testified of what he had told them about sex acts that he liked and enjoyed. I mean, from defecation to urination, he was most certainly probably bisexual in the sense that we had witnesses that he had told of actually going to gay bars and having threesomes with guys and gals and that sort of thing. So he was, Judge Hinojosa in the child custody hearing, I think he probably said it best, in all his years on the bench and doing family law, he had never seen such a person come to his, in his courtroom.
But all of this, of course, is not a criminal offense.
No, it's not.
But for Sergeant Billingsley, the most disquieting aspect of his investigation was Mary Gibb, Pristash's girlfriend. She knew of the murder plot and could have prevented everything.
Anything that I would say about Mary Gibb would be speculation, but my speculation is that it was more important to her to keep her relationship with Pristash intact than it was to warn Farrah Fraudah. And I know that for a decent person that is inexplicable, but it's kind of akin to women who are in domestic situations where, let's say, their boyfriend is sexually abusing their child. They might know that, but they don't want to lose their boyfriend. They would rather sacrifice their child than to lose their boyfriend. And I think that...
You've seen cases like that.
Yes, there are many cases like that. And I think that Mary Gibb was very caught up into Pristash was her boyfriend, and so therefore she was going to keep her boyfriend. Only when it really became necessary did Mary Gibb step forward, and that was when she was about to be taken to the grand jury. And I think then it was probably self-preservation.
Within hours of being subpoenaed, she struck a deal with a DA.
I said, wait a minute, are you charging me with murder? And he said, yes. And I went, wait a minute.
She was granted immunity in exchange for telling everything she knew. This is Mary Gibb to the left, testifying in court. To the right, a projection of Joe Pristash.
Mary could have prevented this whole thing. Mary knew enough information that she could pick the phone up and call law enforcement and stop the killing. It wouldn't ever have happened.
Or dissuade Pristash, or try to dissuade him.
Correct.
Or even contact Farrah herself.
Yeah. Damn, she had a lot of opportunities. And, that's Eventually, she agreed to do the right thing, but basically that was because that she was, looking at going to jail herself.
She herself is a monster. She should be where her father is.
Mary Gibb.
Mm-hmm.
Explain, please.
Because she knew everything that was going on. The night of the murder, she knew what her boyfriend was, because they were living together, where he was going. Because after the murder, he came back. He had the gun with him. He emptied the gun, the bullets on the bed, the spent bullets, and he took the gun and he hid it under the bed. And he left. Apparently, he left to go and collect his money from the payoff from Frada. While he was gone, she, in the meantime, she goes, gets the gun out, she makes a note of the serial number of the gun, and takes that paper and hides it under a flower pot on the veranda, on the patio, and put the gun back in its place.
If she would have acted differently...
Mary Gibb, yeah.
Yeah, if she would have acted differently, maybe I'd have even the slightest bit of respect for her for owning up to it and saying, hey, I should go to the cops, I should do something. But she's a soulless, heartless woman, and I have no respect for her whatsoever, and I have no care for her. I don't care what goes on in her life. She's a just dirty, like, grimy woman, and I don't care for her. She's absolutely just awful. Like, I don't even know how to put it really into words how much anger I have for her right now, but if it was different, maybe then I could say, okay, I respect for you for actually saying I knew what was going on, and I did something to prevent it.
She was even at the same gym.
Mm-hmm. She's not my mother.
She could have spoken to her secretly.
Several times.
Vivian King, can I ask you, as a human being, not the defense attorney, why would a woman not do something?
That makes me very suspicious. As a woman, I would certainly warn that person. I would warn a stranger that I just heard about in a gym. I wouldn't have to know them to do that. So I think that's very suspicious. Also adding to the theory that we wanted to present, that she and Price Dash had Farah murdered, and they were going to blackmail Robert Frada because it was told that he had a lot of money. In the gym, he bragged about money, about a big inheritance. He also bragged about different things, and it was also a rumor that Price Dash had killed other people. He'd been a former police officer who had been involved with some murders for hire. So it was plausible, based on our investigation of people rumoring and saying things, that they could have just taken the initiative to have her killed with the intention of blackmailing Mr. Frada. And that's why his girlfriend kept the serial number. That's why she kept quiet, because she could have very easily warned Farah.
Are you involved in it, or do you deny being involved? I would like to hear from you.
Yeah, sure. I had nothing to do with my wife's death at all. I've been professing my innocence from the onset, and as far as what happened, I found out in 1998 from my co-defendants a lot of information, and including with the person who was involved, and my attorneys at one point tried to get all the information that this one person, whose first name is Kevin, went to the police on his own accord to tell them exactly what happened and what he knew about Farah. And approximately a week later, he was found dead in his backyard. And prior to his death, he had told his girlfriend and mother that he was in fear for his life after speaking with the detectives, the same detectives who investigated my case, and he was murdered.
Our main line of defense is that he's not guilty. He told us he was not guilty. It was believable.
His first conviction was overturned after many years.
Many years, about yes. 15 years. That was very unusual. And the U.S. Supreme Court said the case had to be retried within 120 days or he had to be released.
So you were retried, and in principle, if the jury would have found you not guilty, you would have walked free.
Yes.
And what happened Why was this overturned of your first conviction? What was the reason?
The reason was because of the confrontation clause of the U.S. Constitution, that we have a right to confront the witnesses against us, and I didn't have that right in either trial, as a matter of fact. Neither time were Price, Dash, and Guidry called to testify as to what truly happened. So that's how the conviction got overturned the first time.
Videotaping is Sergeant Danny Billingsley, and alongside him is Deputy Mitch Merry. To my right is Howard Guidry. Howard, I want to read something to you, and I want you to listen to me, okay? You have the right to remain silent and not make...
On the walkthrough interview, videotape interview, it's very obvious on the interview that he's read his rights every time that camera comes on. He's read his rights. And it's obvious to see it. I even asked him at one point, have you been mistreated in any way or coerced? And he said no. It's obvious he's very comfortable. He's not under any kind of duress or stress at this point. He's pretty calm and pretty matter-of-fact about the whole thing. The Judge Vanessa Gilmore, federal district judge in Houston, heard this case based on the credibility of the witnesses. Now, I don't have a problem with overturning a criminal case. That's our system. I may not agree with it, but I don't really have a problem with it. The problem I got was when Vanessa Gilmore wrote in her opinion that she found the investigators to not be credible, and she found the defendant to be credible.
And you were not credible.
I was not credible. And the defendant was credible. A man who had committed burglary in Louisiana, had come to Texas, did a capital murder, had did an armed robbery in Texas, robbed a bank, went to prison, escaped out of death row one time, was recaptured, and the next time took a female guard hostage. He's credible, but we're not credible. That's the problem I have with what went on in this case. And in fact, it led, that opinion led to the overturning of the Frada case. Of course, they were both retried and both convicted again.
Again, capital punishment for both.
Yes, again, capital punishment.
Is there still something seething inside of you?
Oh, I won't ever get over that. And the other detectives involved felt the same way, you know, I've worked 30 years in law enforcement and tried to maintain a honorable ethical standard that I work by, and so did these other people. And then to have some judge write such trash, in my opinion, it was, you know, I can't even get inside of their head. I don't even know why she'd even do that.
And it's many years back.
Yes.
And you're still smarting.
Yeah, I'm still smarting. And we'll always smart from it.
Because of the retrials, the clock for execution of Frutter and Guidry has been reset. All three of the perpetrators are held in solitary confinement on death row at Polunsky. Frutter loses himself in dreams and religious revelations, as if a finger of God had pointed at him.
It was Jesus' voice talking to me about contacting the Mormon church, and he gave me information about them, and it coincided with previous, what I firmly believe are revelations of God for me to write about a new government system and forming a new country. And I followed the instructions of the dream. I contacted the Mormon church. They sent me their Book of Mormon, and everything that I read matched the information that was given to me in the dream. And, you know, that's not something that's going to happen, especially when you have no knowledge of this at all. So that's what I'm saying. It had a big impact on my life.
You do have some ideas and dreams of an utopian state. Close your eyes and you form the new United States of America.
Well,
or the new Texas.
Actually, I call it the Kingdom of Zion. That's what I was told to call it. And it would just be, in my dreams, just a part of the United States that we would, like the Christians, would go ahead and just be given our own land within the United States to form our own nation called the Kingdom of Zion. And then the government, would be based on a system that I wrote about called ADAM, which is an acronym for Democratic Absolute Monarchy. And it's where we vote for a king, and the king would be a Christian king, and things would be done in alignment with the Bible. It would be a Christian nation, and we don't have that now. This country has turned its back on God.
And would it be your kingdom of Zion somehow separate as an Aryan nation?
people want to actually live amongst their own. And when you read the scriptures in the Bible, and that's, I quote the Bible all throughout my writings, of how God commanded separation. He made the different races, he made them speak the different languages and scattered them around the earth and gave them their boundaries. That's all in the Bible. So nothing has changed except, to me, Satan has come in and deceived man into saying, hey, no, you're supposed to interlive and intermarry. So in order for us not to have racism and to have love for each other as the different races and languages and even religions, is to go what God said and go back to being separate, so the Muslims would live with the Muslims, like you said, the white Christians. But you have so many intermixed people that the intermixed people would just make their choice as to which they would want to live in. As far as any particular dreams, there's really nothing consistent. I've had dreams even about Superman and Batman. I mean, it's just all because a neighbor of mine, we like comics and talk about things like that. But
you can fly then?
Yes, I can. Well, it's not that I'm Superman, but yes, in fact, I just had a dream about flying the other day, about 6 days ago. And so I have those dreams once in a while, but it's like a floating, flying type of thing. It's nothing fast, nothing like Superman.
There's one thing Marilyn Monroe once famously said. Watch out, you women out there. Watch out for the men with the perfect teeth and the perfect smile. Stay away from them. And Frotta seems to be one of those.
Frotta fits that. Frotta operates by manipulating women. He manipulated women before the offense. He continues to manipulate women on death row. During his second trial, one of the things that came out was that he was making phone calls from the jail to one woman.
You look so sexy and delicious to me. You bring out the animal in me.
And proposing to her, also talking about what his favorite sexual practices were, talking about how he wanted a form of government that he called Adam, A-D-A-M, that he had thought of in his own mind. While this was going on, another woman was sending numerous emails to his defense attorneys. In those emails, unbeknownst to the defense attorney, she also sent nude photographs of herself, and those ended up being given to Frotta, again, unbeknownst to the defense attorney, and they were confiscated in his cell during the trial. And there was another woman who would come to the trial every single day, and she was one of his pen pals, and they would nod, they would wave to each other, they would make little acknowledgments. And she even brought her son with her one day, who looked like he was about 10 or 12.
I believe that there are women who are fascinated by men in prison that they can have power over. They know where they are. Women who have obviously some psychotic tendencies. But I think that same groupie woman can also be after guys that they see playing football or basketball, but they don't know them personally, but they see them on TV. Because the woman that married Frotta while he was on death row had also, I was told, also had been in trouble for going after a baseball player, maybe had a against him, her for going after him, and had used to send him pictures, send our Mr. Frotta pictures. So I think there are women who just like people in the limelight. They like that attention.
And a certain danger which is contained.
That's possible.
Absence of responsibility.
And maybe just the fact that they can read a letter for them, and that man in prison is going to say the things that the man in the free world is not going to say. The man in the free world might be dating multiple women and doesn't have time to document his love in print. Because I know a lot of the women are pen pals with the guys, and the guys are telling them, I love you, I'm going to be there, saying all the things that a free world guy might not say.
But is there such a thing like a fascination with a dangerous man who cannot harm you because he's behind bars?
I could see that. I've never had a woman tell me about that, but I believe that that's possible. And the loyalty factor is what's interesting to me, because they're very loyal to them.
Because they do not hear his snoring at night.
Yeah.
And they don't smell his socks.
Right.
That are unwashed for a fortnight.
That's probably true.
They get friends to set up websites for them. And their websites might say, I have found an attorney who will be able to get me off death row. He can prove I'm innocent. And I only need $200,000. And people send money. They set up accounts. Now, their prison account, they can only have $200 in. But a relative or a friend can set up any bank account and put money in it for them. There was one particular individual here in Harris County who managed to hook up with someone in France, and an entire village in France adopted him, and his website was in English and in French so that the French people could send him money, and he received quite a bit of money. And the irony was, he had pled guilty to the offense, but his website was, if you give me $200,000, I can prove my innocence.
He's an honorary citizen of this French village now.
He was. He has been executed. But up until then, yes, he was.
Okay. Unquestionably, there were sweet moments with Frata and his family. These were like bubbles that would burst abruptly.
Yes.
What is quite often overlooked beyond the crime and its victims are additional victims. In this case, the children who, in a way, lost both parents. However, in all the idyllic home videos, two brief moments now look somehow eerie, beyond clowning.
Just
here, the moment when Frata's baby girl Amber was just born. Today, the same girl only wants to see her father dead.
The girl is very bitter. The girl is very bitter, but the boys, what I can from conversation gather, they are either here nor there.
But your granddaughter, Frata's daughter, she wants him dead.
Oh yes, that's right. She's told him that. The next time I see you, you'll be on the gurney.
You can talk to her.
Have you met your father on death row?
I actually went to go visit him one time.
How long ago?
That was just before his retrial, about 3 years ago. Well, actually about 4 years ago was when I went to go see him. So I did, one time only.
Can you tell me about this visit?
It was interesting. He basically had told me at one point, because I was so angry at him, and I asked him flat out, I said, you know, just admit it. Why'd you do it? And he turns around, he tells me he thinks I'm a very angry person and that I need Christian counseling. So at the end of that conversation, I pretty much was like, all right, I'll see you in court. You know, I don't want anything else to do with you. I'm done with this conversation. You're never gonna own up to what you did. So it was, I cried, I did, out of anger, but it was a very interesting visit, I guess you could say.
Would you ever see him again?
Honestly, I don't know. I've been asked that question before, and after the whole retrial and, you know, having to go through that with my grandparents, you know, being older, I don't know at this point, maybe. Other than that, I only know that whenever he gets his death sentence, you know, whenever I did go to see him, I did say that I was going to be there. So
during execution.
Mm-hmm. Part of me does want to be there. You know, it is going to still be hard for me because he's still my dad. But at the same time, he's guilty. I know he is. And I just want it all to be over with. So I have no plans really to see him other than that, as far as I know.
Are you afraid sometimes what's coming at you?
Oh, no, not at all. Are you kidding? I pray to God every night to take me in my sleep. I'm not afraid of death. Not at all.
You've been in the police force, firefighter as well. Is there a special training that you are not afraid anymore? I wish everyone had your attitude.
I don't know about that. I mean, I will say this, having been in the emergency field, firefighting and police and EMT or ECA, you learn to control your emotions and not let emergency situations get you startled. So yeah, I learned that. But as far as not being afraid to die, I think that's more of my relationship with God. I'm ready. So yeah, I don't mind dying at all.
Can you see yourself in the death house in Huntsville?
No, not at all.
It's completely off your
mind.
It's
not even on there, no. It won't happen.
If you enjoyed this documentary, head to SBS On Demand anytime for over 250 documentaries to keep you informed.